A workflow that doesn't really flow, nor work. What's the point? But that's what we ended up with last time. So it's time to write the actual activity. It's time to turn our simple code into an actual workflow. It's time to check that incoming data. It's time to dive under the hood of durable functions. In short, it's time. In the last video, which you can find here, we created a framework for our orchestration. We set up a trigger HTTP function that we called from our test environment in Visual Studio Code, and we made sure that that function started an orchestration. We added some logging, and when we ran it, we saw something happening in our output. Now, of course, the calling client, again in this case Visual Studio Code with the REST client extension installs, it sees this, a boring 200 OK status code. Now in this video we will do the last thing we need to do to make this code an actual workflow. We'll add the first step from our sequence. Now if you remember, the steps we need to take to allow Annette to our events were 1. Check her details. 2. Check with the other user groups. 3. Check with the board and handle that. And 4. Finalize the registration. Now, although this is a simple workflow, we won't even be able to do all of those steps in this video. We will only do the first one, check her details. Still, a workflow of one step, it's still a workflow. And the rest, it's just a matter of repeating. Spoiler, it's not. There's a lot more interesting stuff to be found in each one of those steps. Anyway, we'll use that first step of checking to make sure that the flow works. And then we will see how this all works behind the curtains. So, load up the project that we started last time and follow along. We are going to build the code that checks the data that the potential attendee, we call her Annette, gives us. The data consists of her name, her email address and the meeting date. Now, we should be checking all of them, well, maybe with the exception of her name, but since we are here to talk about Azure Durable Functions and not about how to check data, we're going to simplify this. We are only going to check her email address. And if you want to check the other items as well, well, be my guest. Now, I like to have a lot of different DTOs. They are simple, they are lightweight and easy to use. And with the upcoming C# 9, we can even have records, which are sort of classes especially made for this purpose. Now, however, since Azure Durable Functions are not compatible with .NET 5 yet, we cannot use them. Oh well. So, we can create lightweight classes, and I always make sure not to pass more data to my functions than necessary. That way, I make it easier to reuse them later on. We are going to make a new DTO called Data to Verify, and it is very simple. Now, it only has an email address and a constructor that passes that address. Okay, with that out of the way, we can build our actual business code. So far, we have written a function that we can use with a trigger to start the workflow, register attendee. And then we wrote another function, the orchestration, which is started by register attendee and controls a step in that workflow. And we call that run registration. So we start the chain of events with register attendee, that fires up the orchestration instance in run registration, and that should start all the workflow steps. Got it? Okay, let me show it once again. Now, all we do now is log some data to the console and return an it's all okay status, and that's clearly not enough. We need to create the actual steps, or as we call them, activities. And guess what? An activity is just an Azure function, just like the orchestration function is. Now, the orchestration function has a special attribute, orchestration trigger. This is a binding that makes sure that this is starting the actual workflow for this instance with all of its data stored in that iDurable orchestration context that we call context. In our case, this holds the potential attendee data. Now, activities are very similar to that. Let me show you. Okay, Let's go through this line by line. First, we have to give the activity a name. Again, it's just an Azure function and they all have names, so we need one here as well. And Verify Data, it's just a good name, don't you think? Okay, then we have the header for the method Verify Data. We have an attribute, activity trigger. Now, this binding tells the system that this is an actual step in the workflow. This attribute goes before the data that's passed into the function. And that can be any type, as long as it's serializable. Now, with the orchestration, we had to call context.getInput. With the activity, we get it in the parameter list. Again, the type doesn't really matter as long as it's serializable. And our DTO is. So, we have a data to verify instance stored in data to verify, and we decorated it with an attribute to make sure that this is an activity triggered function. And of course, our old friend the locker is here as well. And then I go into the terribly complicated code of checking the email address. Now, what I should have done is write some weird regex stuff, but A, I never understood those, and B, there are other courses for that. This is, for us, it's good enough. Now, in the code itself, there is nothing special going on. An activity function is just a C# method with these two extra attributes. The inner code does nothing special. We check the input and we return the result. And I mean, we could have even left out that async in the declaration and just returned true or false. But I like my code to be symmetric, and since most Azure functions will be async, I want them to look all the same. Now, this is not something that you do in your backend business code, but in this code, I like to do it this way. Okay, we have the activity. Now, all we need to do is go to our orchestration and make sure that the activity is called. If we call this activity and the email address is not valid, then we need to inform the calling system. So we will expand our registration status so that it looks like this. We added the no valid data state so that we can identify what went wrong. Now, let's call that activity. Now, in the orchestration function, add the following code. The part that matters here is this line. We use the context to call activity async. And we specify we get a bool back, we give it a function name, and then we give it the data. In our case, we give it a new instance of data to verify with a supplied email address. The function will return true or false, and then we log that result. If it's false, we return a new registration result, informing Annette that she's made a mess of her entry. And if not, well, we go on to the next step. And since this is the only step we have in our workflow, we just return with an "Hey, all is well, we can't wait to see you at the next event" message. And let's just run it. And that's it. That's all there is to it. There's really not a lot more that I can say about this all. Yes, it is that simple.
Whoa. What? Wait a minute. Not so fast. Can you run that thing again? I mean, clean this time?
Sure. Hold on.
See, I see two instances of that log saying startup registration. You made a mistake, buddy.
No, wait.
You're calling it twice.
I make no mistakes. I make intentionally alternative code.
Why is this here twice then? Fix that.
Okay, you got me. Now just go away and leave me to handle this, right? Okay, so, well, he is right. There is something wrong. The truth is, we did make a mistake, but it's probably not what you think. It's not that we are calling the function twice. Yet it seems that there is something wrong with the double locking. So what's going on? Okay, to explain, I need to open up the hood, draw back the curtains, and show you how durable functions really work behind the scenes. Okay, bear with me. The cool part about Azure Job Functions is that they make complicated stuff seem very easy. In the first video of this series, I said that with complicated workflows, you would end up with a lot of plumbing, and that durable functions can help with removing that plumbing for us. And that is what we are seeing here. I mean, take this line, for instance. Now, if you look at it, it seems very simple. I mean, you call that verify data function, probably on another thread or so, while this function sit and wait until that's done. And then when it's done, it takes that resulting Boolean, it stores it into data is valid, and it continues. And that is not what is happening. The truth is way more complex. See, that await context call activity async looked like it's calling another method. Now, if we had written it like this, yeah, then that would have been what is happening. We would have called it C# method in this class, but then the activity would have been called in the app domain of our current process. And thus it would not be scalable. I mean, what if we wanted the activity to run somewhere else in a scaled up app service or maybe somewhere else in the world? I mean, they are Azure functions and that is what you can do with Azure functions. But by calling it like this, you cannot do that. The first code, the one that we actually use, it seems to work exactly the same way as that line that we just dismissed, but it does things rather differently. And that is what makes durable functions so great. They take away the complexity and they make it look like something we are used to. So, how does this work? Okay, first, in the previous videos, I made a couple of statements. Remember when I said this? Again, durable functions are just Azure functions. And then I also said this. We can also have queue triggers. We specify what queue we want our function to watch, and as soon as something is placed in that queue, our function will pick it up and start doing. Now, I said those things with a reason. Now, this is the big one. Ready? Orchestration functions and activity functions are nothing more than queue triggered regular Azure functions. They are just too shy to admit that. Think about that. See if you can guess where I'm going with this. Okay, let me show you. I will be simplifying things a lot and also tell some wild lies, but the base idea is still valid. We have this first function called register attendee. We call start new here, and most people assume that that calls the function with the orchestration trigger. That's not really what's happening. What happens is that this call takes that potential attendee data and stores it in a table in the table storage. Now, remember when I said table storage was important for durable functions? Okay, then it places a new item on a special queue. Let's call it the orchestration queue. In that item, it stores the instance ID and info about where to get data from the table storage. Okay, if you are new to queue triggered functions, they are basically very simple to understand. The runtime watches the queues, which you can see as a table in a database, and if a new row is inserted, it will see in a list if there are functions that want to be alerted of this. And if it finds one, it will instantiate the code that holds that function and calls it with the data from the table. So when this item is placed on the queue, the orchestration function, which is just a queue-triggered Azure function, pick it up. The data is stored in the context and the code begins to run. Now, the first line takes the data from the context. But what happens in reality is that with the information the context has from the queue, it knows where to get the data from the table storage. And this is why it needs to be a serializable class. The data is serialized before stored and then deserialized when picked up. So this get input reads data from the table and then stores it into the variable. Okay, the second line is the log. Well, there's nothing special about it. The code is executed and we see the results in the console. And then we call the activity. Or rather, we don't. The same thing happens here as with the orchestration. Data is pushed in a table. And then an item is pushed on a different queue. Let's call it the activity queue. And then, wait for it. This C# method, it dies. It is no more. It has ceased to be. It has expired and gone to meet its maker. It's a stift, bereft of life it is. This is an expanded... Okay, sorry about that. I got carried away. The method goes out of scope, out of memory. The whole abdomen can be garbage collected. The process is shut down. You see what I'm saying? In the middle of a method, it's being killed off without returning. But before it does that, it stores its state in the table storage. Now, in the meantime, our activity has seen that an item is placed in the queue it is watching, and it picks it up. It loads the data in the form of a data to validate, places it in that variable, and does its job. And at the end of the work, it doesn't just go away. No, it adds a new item to that orchestration queue. And in that item, it holds information about the results of the activity and where the orchestration can find those. Now, the orchestration sees this new item in a queue and starts up again, and starts all over. It loads the potential attendee data from the table, again. It logs the line to the console, again. And then it encounters the line where it is supposed to call the activity. But since it knows its state, because that was stored just before it died, it can see that it already has called that. And since the activity was kind enough to place information about the result somewhere, the orchestration can just pick up the result and not call the activity again. And then it moves on to the next line. And if that were to be another activity call, the same thing would happen again. It would place the item on the queue, it will die, it waits for a signal to be brought back to life, then it starts all over again, it reads a potential attendee, logs to the console, skips the first data activity because it already did that and it loads the results, skips the second activity, loads that results, and so on and so on. This dying only happens when it needs to call an activity. Oh, and in a sub-orchestration, but we'll do those in two videos from now. The other statements, such as locking and if statements, are happening every single time. And that, my friend, is how this all works behind the scenes. Now, this all means that if the orchestration starts up on a machine in the Azure data center of West Europe, but the data center suddenly gets very busy, it's very well possible that the activity itself is running in Asia, if we have set our scaling that way. And when Asia also gets busy at the time, the second run of the orchestration can suddenly be running on a machine somewhere on the American continent. It doesn't really matter. The data is stored in table storage and queue storage, and if that can be reached, it doesn't matter where execution takes place. We are server agnostic, I mean serverless, remember? Now, in reality, this probably will take place on the same machine all the time, or at least on machines that are physically close to one another to reduce latency. But it could happen. We are extremely scalable this way. Much more scalable than we would have been if we called the C# methods ourselves. Of course, this comes with some downsides. First, this is way slower than just calling C# methods in the same abdomen. But there are two other things that you need to be aware of. One of them is a bit more subtle than the other. Now, first, that locking happens all the time. And we can prevent that quite easily. Just add the following line to the code. This isReplaying can change all the time over each line in the method. I mean, it's false the first time this line is hit. It's true the second time this line is hit. And of course, I mean per instance of the workflow, not in total. If someone else would register for our event, the whole circuit starts all over again clean. Now, don't do this for calling the activities. Don't prevent activities from being called multiple times. The runtime does that already by actually making it run the first time and getting the data only from the table storage the second time and third time and so on. Use this isReplaying sparingly. For locking, this is just fine. But there's another thing that is a potential problem, and that is this. Now assume we have this dummy orchestration. Okay, we have extended the potential attendee with a registration date, so we know when we start working on this. And of course we set this to UTC now. Now assume we have this flow in our orchestration. Let's say that if we are 2 days away from the actual event, we don't bother chucking with the board. After all, it could take longer than 2 days for them to respond to their emails. And that registers just 1 second before midnight, before the 2-day period. So the flow goes into the board checking activity. But after the resurrection, this is called again. And the get input gets the original data as it was given to us by the register attendee function. So the registration date is the default date time again. And then we set it to UTC. But now we have gone past midnight. And that means that the flow in the method changes. In an orchestration function, we cannot do anything that might alter the flow. After all, if this were a continuous method, like we would expect a normal C# method to be, this wouldn't happen. Variables do not change values in the middle of a method all of a sudden automatically. You would not expect this. And in orchestrations, you are just not allowed to do things like this. So getting datetime UTC now is not going to work. And neither is generating a new GUID. That's also different every single time that you call it. Reading from a database, reading a file, settings, getting something from the network, all those things are not guaranteed repeatable and should not be done in an orchestration method. Now, this sounds limiting, and in a way it is, but it's not a big deal. If you need to read something from the database, for instance, just put that code in an activity and call that in the orchestration. The first time that this instance encounters this, it will do the actual work and store it in the table storage. And the next time it will get that data from the table storage and we have a repeatable flow. Now, you don't need to do this with trivial items such as datetime and GUID. The context has these two methods that we can use. These two calls will return the same value every time in this instance. You still can't put it into a potential attendee since this will lose it the next time this instance encounters this line. But this way we can use datetime and GUID in a simple and repeatable way. And for all the other things, use an activity. So, there we have it. This is how durable functions actually work. Aren't you happy the framework takes care of all of this? Now, we have a fully working workflow now. We can call it from the outside and we check the data in a separate activity. Okay, I agree, it's not very impressive, but hey, it's a real one. Now, in the next video, we will add the next activity where we will inform all the other user groups about Annette's intention to come to our meetings. And this allows us to explore running activities in parallel. And we will investigate fanning out. And if you want to know what that means, well, I suggest you subscribe and hit that notification bell. That way you won't miss anything that I put online. It would be a shame if you missed the next exciting installment. There's still so much to learn and to explore in the wonderful world of Azure Durable Functions. But until then, I hope you enjoyed this part and learned something about these things and how they work behind the scenes. And I hope to see you again next time.